Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's stand today. We're going to worship God in this place. Let's just lift our hands to heaven for a moment. Give God praise. The Bible says, let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. So this morning, Lord Jesus, we just give you today. We give you this moment, our time together. God bless our worship. Lord, may it be a sweet sound in your ears today. We love you, Jesus. And everybody said, amen. Let's worship him.
You see an empty tomb. We're continuing our series on Joshua called Stronger, and today we're talking about Joshua chapter 10. Now, I don't know about you. I don't know if you are big fans of battles, of movies that have big war scenes and battle scenes in them, and maybe you like the history, you like to study that kind of stuff, or you like to read books on battles or documentaries about that kind of stuff, but I will be totally honest with you and say that is not my favorite thing. It's not my favorite thing to watch. It's not my favorite thing to study or to read. I was reading this really great book on one of the presidents. It was kind of biographical, but I am telling you, I just got lost. There was like so much battle stuff in there. I just was like, how many pages do I have to turn to get through some of this? It was just overwhelming to me. And you know, but my family really likes that kind of stuff. All right, they really like it. There's explosions and shooting and, I mean, war cries and whatever. They like that. And so sometimes I have to watch it with them. And it's sort of a running joke that if that's going to happen, I'm probably going to fall asleep. So you know if you take me to the movies, whoever sits on the left side of me has to be my pillow. And then, you know, we'll watch the movie again at home, and I'll be like, I've never seen this. And they're like, Mom, this is the one you slept through. So I really try. But, you know, the battles and conquests and heroes and enemies, this is where our story takes place today. And I said last week that Joshua is a book that we could title God is Faithful. Now, throughout this book of the Bible, we see time and time again the faithfulness of God on display, right, for the Israelites. We see that this book is full of battles, cities being conquered. You know, we see heroes, we see walls falling down, we see, you know, lots of land allotments. We talked about that last week, lots of boundaries, and you can just get lost in the reading of that. Have you ever read the book of Numbers? And you can get lost, right? And Joshua starts out really big and epic, and it's just these great stories. And as you get on further and further, there's all these things, and you're just like, oh, my eyes sometimes just glaze over. And but in the middle of these land allotments, in the middle of these battles, are huge examples and pictures of God's faithfulness to us. And if you don't stop and read through them, you will miss out on some of the coolest things that God has ever done. Now, there's three points that we've said that this series is kind of wrapped around, and I just want to throw those out there for you again, and they are this, that we are called to be people of the Word, right? That we are called to follow where God is leading, and we are called to step out in faith. Now, God promised Joshua in chapter 1 that everywhere that the Israelites would put their feet, that it would be land that belonged to them. But the land was not move-in ready, right? Along with the promised land was the stipulation that they had to conquer that land first. Yes, every place they went was theirs, but they had to fight for it, right? They had to conquer it. But God said it was theirs already. It was theirs, it belonged to them, but they had to step out in faith. They had to be active about it, and God said he would be with them. So conquering land, it meant fighting battles. It meant death and destruction, and the people that inhabited the promised land had to go because that land was promised to God's children. And the Lord gave Joshua and the leaders specific instructions about the people in the promised land. And one of those instructions was that they were not to make any kind of treaty, any kind of alliance with the people that lived in the land. But unfortunately, the Israelites were deceived. And in Joshua chapter 9, you can read about that. They were deceived. They didn't consult the Lord. And they ended up making a treaty with the Gibeonites. And when the Gibeonites found themselves in trouble, they came to Joshua and the Israelites for help. And I love that Joshua was a man of his word. He was a man of his word, and he helped and he fought with them. And that's where our story picks up today. Joshua chapter 10. If you're if you're not there, let's turn to it. And I'm going to read verses 1 through 13 to you today. And it says this, it says in verse 1, Adonai Zedek, king of Jerusalem, heard that Joshua had captured and completely destroyed Ai and killed its king, just as he had destroyed the town of Jericho and killed its king. He also learned that the Gibeonites had made peace with Israel, and they were now their allies. He and his people became very afraid when they heard all this, because Gibeon was a large town, as large as the royal cities and larger than Ai, and the Gibeonite men were strong warriors. So King Adonai Zedek of Jerusalem sent messengers to several other kings. I'm not going to give you all their names, but they're the kings of Hebron, of Jarmuth, of Lachish, and of Eglon. And they came, and he said, come and help me destroy Gibeon. He said, for the people have made peace with Joshua and the people of Israel. So these five Amorite kings combined their armies for a united attack. They moved all their troops into place and attacked Gibeon. And the men of Gibeon quickly sent messengers to Joshua at his camp in Gilgal. Don't abandon your servants now, they pleaded. Come at once, save us, help us, for all the Amorite kings who live in the country have joined forces to attack us. So Joshua and his entire army, including his best warriors, left Gilgal and set out for Gibeon. Do not be afraid of them, the Lord said to Joshua, for I have given you victory over them. Not a single one of them will be able to stand up to you. Joshua traveled all night from Gilgal and took the Amorite armies by surprise. The Lord threw them into a panic, and the Israelites slaughtered great numbers of them. Then the Israelites chased the enemy along the road to Beth Horon, killing them along the way to Azekah and Makkedah. And as the Amorites retreated down the road from Beth Horon, the Lord destroyed them with a terrible hailstorm from heaven that continued until they reached Azekah. And the hail killed more of the enemy than the Israelites killed with the sword. And on the day the Lord gave the Israelites victory over the Amorites, Joshua prayed to the Lord in front of all of the people of Israel. And this is what he said. Let the sun stand still over Gibeon and the moon over the valley of Ajalon. So the sun stood still and the moon stayed in place until the nation of Israel had defeated its enemies. Now, I don't know if you caught what just happened here. I told you I don't like to read about battles. I've read this chapter so many times over the years and never caught what was going on here until probably about 3 years ago, actually, when my older kids and I were studying this. And in fact, I think in my Bible, I have written it, next to this, did time just stand still with a question mark? People, that is crazy. Time just stood still. This isn't sci-fi, right? Gene Roddenberry did not think this up. Jesus thought it up. God made time stand still. He is so cool. He's just awesome. Joshua knew that they needed more time to defeat the enemy armies, and they didn't have enough day left. So he called out to the only one that could help him. 100% of the prayers that we don't pray don't get answered. Joshua had the audacity. Do you like that word? It sounds like a weighty word, doesn't it? It's like this. He had the audacity to pray for the impossible. God created the world, right? He created the universe, the solar system, the galaxies, the heavens, the earth, the sun, the moon, and they all follow laws of nature. But God, with his word, can suspend the laws of nature. And he can make time stand still. And I just think our finite minds, they just cannot really grasp the length and the breadth of God's power. I mean, it's just beyond our comprehension, right? We see this in movies. How many times does time stand still? Or people go back in time or they come forward. That's not real, though. But it is real. God did it. And he did it in this, you know, situation. So I think sometimes we don't pray prayers that are bigger, that are big enough, because we can't conceive them as being answerable. I don't know if that's you ever, but I know 100% that there are things that I have not prayed because I just think that will never happen. There's no way. It's not going to happen. That person's too far gone, right? That thing is way too big. All of these things, because I can't comprehend it, because I can't wrap my mind around it. I don't think that the God who created the universe, who can beam people from one place to the other, who can stop time, that he's big enough. He is big enough. Let me tell you, he's big enough. He's big enough. So I have just a couple thoughts I want you to think today or you know, ways to encourage you. And number one is I want you to be audacious in your prayers. Pray big, scary, desperate prayers and pray them with faith. Pray them trusting and relying on the faithfulness of God. Right? We just said 100% of the prayers we don't pray don't get answered. Joshua could have not prayed this prayer. He could have just said, God help us. God help us not to die today. Or, you know, God help them to get tired. Or help them, you know, send another hailstorm. We can't do it. But he brought out the big guns, right? And I love that in verse 12, the Bible points out that Joshua didn't just pray this prayer quietly. He didn't retreat and go back to his tent. He didn't just pray it in his head or under his breath. Right? Verse 12 says that he prayed it in the presence of all of Israel. He prayed it out loud. Oh God, make the sun stand still over here and make the moon not rise over here. Everybody would know what he prayed. Everybody would know if God didn't stop time. But everybody was able to see and hear that their leader had the audacity to pray this kind of prayer because he believed in the faithfulness of God. Joshua was able to pray the impossible because he knew that he served a God that was big enough to handle that kind of prayer. Whether God answered in the way Joshua asked or not, did it matter? He still trusted God. He still knew that God would fight for them, that God would help them win the battle because God said he would. Joshua had spent decades serving. Joshua was not a young man by this time. He was in his 80s, right? He'd spent time in God's presence. He'd seen God bring them through the desert. He'd seen rivers become highways. He'd seen food from heaven. He'd seen water from the rock and clouds by day and fire by night. He'd seen walls come tumbling down with just praise and worship. He knew that God could be trusted with his biggest requests. He could bet it all on the faithfulness of God, right? He knew God's faithfulness was a sure thing. There are some things that, you know, I just trust about my husband. I know his character. I know the kind of man that he is. I know what he does or what he doesn't do. I know that I can trust him because he's shown me over time that he can be trusted. He's shown me by his words, by his actions, by his presence in my life, the kind of man that he is. And there are some things, church, that I never have fear of. When it comes to him, I will never wonder. I will never question about him because he has shown me that I don't have to. And this is the kind of relationship that Joshua had with God. He knew what level of prayer that he could pray because he knew that with God, nothing was impossible. He knew that his trust in the Lord and in his ability to come through for the Israelites was not misplaced. He knew that if anybody could intervene, if anybody could move on their behalf, God was the one who would do it. Joshua didn't know the outcome of his prayer. Sometimes we pray and God does not answer the way that we want to, right? Sometimes we stay sick. Sometimes our loved ones die. Sometimes we lose our jobs. Our marriage falls apart. Our house burns down. Our kids choose not to follow Jesus. Sometimes God, his answer just doesn't make sense. But that doesn't make him any less faithful. It doesn't make him any less worthy of our trust. We've said that even through this series, that God sees the big picture. He sees the big picture. I heard a pastor say this week that one of God's promises is that we would have troubles. Now, last week we talked about God's promises. And you know, we love the good promises, right? We love the promises with blessing and the healthy and the happy and the favored promises. But we don't always like to think about promises like that, promises that say troubles. Jesus says, in fact, in John chapter 16, he says, I have told you this so that you may have peace. But he says, here on earth, you will have many trials and sorrows. But take heart, because I have overcome the world. Church, sometimes we pray and we won't get the answer that we wanted. Right? We've prayed for people not to pass away, and they have. And that just doesn't make any sense. You know, we've prayed for marriages not to break up, and they still have. But that doesn't mean that we don't continue to pray. That doesn't mean that God's not working. That doesn't mean that God is not there. I understand loss. I understand hurt. I understand frustration. Have you ever just been frustrated at the answers that God sometimes has? Some days you just walk away and you just say, I don't get it. God, I don't understand what is going on and why that happened. And I don't want you to feel like I'm making light of anything, any, you know, of your situations, anything that you've walked through. But I also know, church, that Jesus is the only one who can help. He's the only one who can help like we need help. He's the, you know, and we just have to be okay with not always getting the answer that we think is best. We just have to trust that he knows. Desperate times call for desperate measures, and sometimes you just have to lay it all on the line and trust God's faithfulness, that he will hear you and he will answer you. Pastor Mark Batterson says that prayer is the difference between the possible and the impossible. He says that God is not offended by our bold prayers, because bold prayers honor God. They tell God that we believe in you. We trust in you. I know I can give this to you, and you are big enough to handle it. You are big enough to answer. Hebrews 4:14 through 16 says, it says, we have a great high priest who has entered heaven, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold firmly to what we believe, because this high priest of ours, church, listen, he understands. He understands our weaknesses, for he has faced all of the same testings that we do, and he did not sin. So let us come boldly to the throne of our gracious God. There we will receive his mercy, and we will find grace to help us when we need it most. Pray audacious prayers. I love that word. Like I said, audacity, it just means to take bold risks. Church, let's be people that take bold risks in our prayers, in our faith. God can make the impossible possible. That is who he is. The Bible reminds us time and time again that nothing is impossible for God, that nothing is too hard for him. The second thing I want you to think on today is to trust that the Lord will fight for you. Trust that he will fight for you. Joshua 10 continues on in, I think, 13 and 14. And it says that the sun stayed in the middle of the sky, and it did not set on a normal day, as on a normal day. There has never been a day like this one before or since when the Lord answered such a prayer. And it says, surely the Lord fought for Israel that day. I love that. Don't let your situation keep you from trusting that God will show up for you. Just because you've prayed in the past and things didn't work out the way that you expected or wanted them to, don't let that keep you from putting your trust in Jesus. I've got a couple quotes that we had last week in our notes, and I'm just going to read them again. And author Lisa Turker says this. She says, we've all walked through seasons where our circumstances don't seem to line up with God's promises, but just because they don't line up doesn't mean God isn't going to show up. We cannot let the difficulty of our circumstance define the faithfulness of God. Right, last week we talked about how the Israelites, how their perception of what was going on, what they thought God was doing, how it clouded their vision. Had they perceived something and they let that perception determine their actions, which led to sin, which led to death. Church, let's not let our perception of what God is doing or what we think he's doing cause us to make wrong choices, cause us to put our trust in other things. Proverbs 3:5 reminds us to trust in the Lord with all of our heart and do not depend on your own understanding. We don't know it all. We sing that song, even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Don't depend on your own understanding. Remember, our understanding is just so finite. I don't care how smart you are. What we can see and grasp and comprehend, understand, is so much smaller than who God is. Oswald Chambers, the great missionary, says, faith is deliberate confidence in the character of God, whose ways you may not understand at the time. Deliberate confidence in the character of God. That means we know, God, we can trust who you are, what your word says. You've said it, I believe it, and that's going to settle it for me. We pray in the natural, knowing, trusting, believing that God will do the supernatural. Church, he wants to do the impossible on our behalf. And I love this story because God used the Israelites' failure, chapter 9, the sin, the treaty that they made. He used this failure to show them his faithfulness. They made the treaty they were not supposed to make, but God redeemed that. God showed up and fought for them. And in fighting this battle, Joshua killed 5 birds with 1 stone. Right? 5 cities, 5 kings, and their people were destroyed. That was 5 battles he didn't have to fight later. Chapter 10 goes on and it tells how Joshua took all of those kings, all of the kings that got together, the 5 Amorite kings, decided that in the middle of battle, it was getting too hot, it was getting too heavy, too heated for them. So they took off and they ran and hid in a cave. And they left their people there to fight and to die. And Joshua and the Israelites killed these kings and the Lord gave them victory over them. In fact, it says that the next day, that they conquered the whole region in a single campaign. Because the Lord, the God of Israel, it says in verse 42, was fighting for his people. Church, our trust is never misplaced when we put it in him. We don't know what he will do in a single campaign. We don't know how much ground we will cover in a single campaign. When we invite Jesus into the equation of our lives, when we are people of the word, when we're following his leading, when we step out in faith, the Lord fights for us. Church, he moves on our behalf. I want to encourage you to pray prayers outside of your realm of understanding. I want you to wonder, how in the world is God going to do this? Be in awe. Let him fight for you. Let him put his power on display. Let him show you his faithfulness. Psalm 23:4 says, even when I walk through the darkest valley, I will not be afraid, because you are close beside me. Your rod and your staff, they protect me and they comfort me. I don't know what you're going through right now. I don't know what big things you might be praying about. Maybe you have prayed with audacity. Maybe you've prayed the impossible, but maybe you haven't prayed because you don't think that God will come through for you. But whatever it is, I want to encourage you to trust him, to pray hard, to pray big, to pray with boldness, to pray with audacity, to pray with tears, to pray with fervor, to pray with tenacity, to pray until something happens, because nothing is too hard for the Lord. I'm going to ask the worship team to come. I'm going to ask you to stand with me as we get ready to close this morning. Last week, I left you with the challenge to seek out, to find what in your life. To find out what in your life is something that you can look at, and every time you see it, you remember God's faithfulness to you. I don't know if you did that. If you didn't, I encourage you to do that this week. I've been trying to do that every day. I shared that with you last week. Every day I've been trying to look through my day and just see, God, what, you know, where have you showed me your faithfulness today? And I've been writing it down. And it's been really cool. But George, nothing is too hard for him. I'm going to ask you to come. I'm going to ask all of you to come this morning, actually. If you're comfortable, just come up front. Let's gather around. If you're not comfortable doing it, that's okay. It's okay. But I just want to pray over you today. Church, I don't know if you're here and you just need to pray some big prayers. You just need to let it go. You just need to lay it all on the line. I want to encourage you to do that. We're here today as a family of believers, and we can encourage each other in this. Pray big prayers. Pray impossible things. Trust him. Trust him with the outcome. Church, he is worthy of that. He can handle it. I don't care how big it seems. He can handle it. Lay it on the altar. And some of you need to pray. You need to grab onto the altar with both of your hands, and you need to not let go until you get your answer. Sometimes we don't get it right away, and we walk away and we leave it. Grab on, hold on to it. Let's close our eyes and let's raise our hands to heaven. And let's just take a minute to surrender to him. Lord Jesus, you are worthy of our trust. You are faithful, faithful, faithful. Lord, you have proven that time and time again. You've shown us all throughout your word that you are worthy. Lord, I pray today if there are some that are struggling, they're struggling with some situations that are going on in their life. Maybe things that have already happened, maybe things that they're walking in right now, or even some big upcoming decisions. Lord, I pray today that you would just touch them, you would speak to them, Lord, you would encourage them to have faith. Pray boldly, pray with audacity, take some risks in prayer. Lord, there might be some here today that we just don't know what the answer is. We don't know how it's going to work out. And it really seems like the prayer that Joshua prayed, it seems that big. God, it seems so big, like a stop time kind of big. But God, there is nothing too hard for you, your word says in Jeremiah. In Luke chapter 1, it says, nothing is impossible. God, you've turned rivers into highways. You've brought water from a rock. Lord, you've transported people from one place to the other. God, there is nothing too hard for you, nothing out of the realm of your hand. And I pray today, Lord, that you would help us to pray. And Lord Jesus, we would trust that you would fight for us. God, your word says in Romans chapter 8 that you intercede on our behalf. Lord, you are praying for us. Lord, we're not in this by ourselves. Help our perception to not cloud our decisions. Lord, help us to know that you will fight for us. We just need to step out. We need to follow. We need to be people of your word. Church, I just want to encourage you while you're up here, just begin to pray. Begin to pray with tenacity and with fervor and with tears. Jesus.
Hey, good morning, Norpol Assembly of God. It's been great having you with us today. Hope you enjoyed the service. Just a reminder, there's a couple different ways you can give. You can give online at northpoleag.org. Or you can give by mail, North Pole Assembly of God, 503 Kidd Boulevard, 99705. We're praying for you. We hope you have a great week. God bless you.